We're going to start with a very natural real-world problem, and then I'm going to explain to you a very different problem in pure mathematics that surprisingly solves this real-world problem. You want to buy something on the internet. So here is you, and here is this online store, and between you is this channel we all know and love called the internet. But the internet is a little bit of a noisy channel. So say if you want to buy something from this store, you might want to send the store 16 numbers, your credit card. So like 8352 whatever 9115.
That's not your credit card.
That's not my credit card. But you want to send 16 numbers over the internet to this store. Or maybe somebody else is sending 16 numbers. And say that your credit card number is 8351 ...... 9115. You really don't want the store to receive your credit card number by mistake instead of somebody else's credit card and charge you. So you want to some way build in redundancy in the way that you send these numbers so that if there's an error, you can first figure out that there's an error, don't charge the wrong person, and second of all, maybe correct that error, you might hope. Okay.
I've heard of this. This is error correction.
This is error correction. I'm going to explain to you one of the first beautiful examples of an error correcting code. Before we do beautiful examples, let's just say, what is the most naive thing you could do? How could you use redundancy to be able to detect when errors occur? Any ideas?
I would imagine sending it twice is useful.
Oh yeah, send the numbers multiple times. So if I had this sequence and I sent them multiple times, I would send 8833552...... 1155. Okay, send each number twice. So now if one error occurs here, I say, aha, I was expecting each pair to be equal, and here's a pair that's not equal, so error. And now I know. But that doesn't let me correct the error because I don't know which was right, two or one. So of course, if I wanted to correct it, send each one three times. So if I send each one three times, I'll be able to correct the errors. Let me just write that down. 888333. I'm actually writing this down for a reason. It's a lot more numbers, right? So if this one becomes a one, now I know it should be a two because two was the most common answer in that triple. But you'll see that this is two times the amount of numbers or three times the amount of numbers. And nobody wants to sit on their browser and wait a long time to make a credit card transaction because you had to send way more numbers. It's unwieldy. So we want a much more efficient way to build in redundancy to solve this problem. Okay, I think I want a new sheet. Well, before I tell you a nice way to solve this problem, now we're going to switch to a totally different problem in pure mathematics. Imagine that you have a collection of random points. So you could think about these points in the xy plane. So each of these has an x coordinate and a y coordinate. When I have this random collection of points, what I want to do with it is I want to thread a curve through this collection of points. And as you can see, what I did, I really wanted my curve to exactly pass through each one of these points. It's not something statistical. I actually want it to pass through each one of those points. And when I have one of these curves that threads through the points, I'll say that this curve interpolates those points. So the main question that you want to understand for interpolation is how complicated does this interpolating curve have to be? So you might imagine, right, if I have more and more random points, if I want a curve that has to exactly pass through all those points, each time it has to hit a new point, it maybe has to twist a little bit or turn or move. So it has to get more complicated as the number of points grows.
I intuitively know what you mean by complicated, but is there a proper definition of the complicated?
We're getting there. We're getting there. So exactly for that reason that I want to quantify this, I'm going to switch this problem around and I'm going to turn it on its head and I'm going to say that I fix some type of curve. And I know this is still very abstract, but we're about to do examples. So fix some type of curve. And once I fix this, I fixed how complicated this curve is already. And then what I ask is, what is the maximum number of random points it interpolates? So I've just flipped the problem on its head. Fix the curve, and then say, given how complicated that curve is, does it have the flexibility to pass through how many types of points? Okay. Should we do some examples? Let's do the first example. Let's suppose I gave you 2 points. So what's the least complicated type of curve that you can think of that interpolates 2 points?
A straight line.
A straight line, definitely. So yes, a line always interpolates 2 points, but if I were to give you 3 points, and remember, I want my points to be random, they probably won't lie on a line. So 2 is the maximum number of points that a line interpolates.
Okay.
Okay, so
I
now-
mean, I thought a line actually covers an infinite number of points, but-
Oh, very, very good point. It does cover infinitely many points. You can imagine I can put some other points onto this line. But these are now not random. And remember that in our main problem, we very judiciously required them to be random points. One way you can think about it is take the points that are on the line and just imagine bumping them all in random directions. If I were to bump these in random directions, like there would no longer be a line, right? It would have to be some sort of twisty curve that would interpolate all those bumped points. Okay, so that was 2 points. Let's try to do more points. Next example, let's do 3 points, okay. Any idea for the simplest type of curve you can think of that interpolates 3 points? You can do it with a circle. So these are very classical results. Of course, Euclid knew a line interpolates 2 points. He also knew a circle interpolates 3 points. And Euclid didn't have equations for these curves or anything. He only had things you could synthetically construct. So you can actually construct the circle interpolating 3 points. It's not going to look good if I freehand it.
Go on. Let's see your skills.
Nope. That looked very elliptical.
That's a terrible circle.
I could have done a much better job with this. Anyhow, so these are two very classical results that were known to Euclid. Same thing, 3 random points. If you have 4 random points, they won't lie on a circle. Okay, so now I want to describe to you another type of curve, but it's built out of polynomials. So it's built out of a polynomial f of x. Let's suppose that we first have a linear polynomial, so a degree 1 polynomial. So let's say this polynomial is like x plus 2. So when you see a polynomial like this, and maybe you think back to school, the first thing you want to do is you want to start graphing the values of this polynomial in the xy plane. Remember, my points are in the xy plane. Let's see, when I plug in 0, I get 2. When I plug in 1, I get 3. When I plug in 2, I get 4. You see where this is going. If I plug in any more values, I always just get the straight line. Right here, and this curve that I am making for you is the graph of this polynomial f of x. I think I'd like another sheet of paper. I'm sorry, I can't write small.
Yeah, no.
Now we're gonna do a degree 2 example. So let's just choose some random polynomial of degree 2, like x squared minus 4x plus 7. So again, I'm gonna graph the values of this polynomial in the xy plane. All right, so if I plug in 0, I'll get 7. So that's 1 point on the graph. If I plug in 1, I'll get 1 minus 4. It's minus 3 plus 7 is 4. 4. If I plug in 2, I'll get 4 minus 8 plus 7. I'll get 3, right? Let's do another one. Let's do 4. If I plug in 4, I'll get 16 minus 16 plus 7. So I just get 7 again. You can see this graph, it looks something like this parabola through those points. So in both of these two problems, what I was doing was I was starting with a polynomial, and then I was getting points on a certain type of curve, which is the graph of a polynomial. So I'm now gonna flip the problem around. This way that I've set up the interpolation problem, we fix the type of curve, which is the graph of a polynomial of a certain degree, and then we want to know how many general points does it interpolate. Okay, so this linear case, it's a line. We already knew how to solve a line. It interpolates 2 general points. So that means I can specify 2 points on here. If I pick any 2 points, I can always find a linear polynomial so that the graph of that polynomial interpolates those 2 points. And now, this has a very explicit description, right? Because these points are of the form some x value, comma f of x, what you're trying to do is you're trying to choose some inputs and then find a polynomial that maps those to specific outputs.
Is it almost like saying, what's the minimum number of points I can have and know what my thing looks like.
It's very related to that. But I'm asking for a, sort of the maximum, the amount of freedom you have, the maximum number of points you can have and still have it lie on such a polynomial. So here you could do 2. For degree 2, any guesses for what it is? It's 3. It's sort of like how you went from a line to a circle, except a circle is not a graph of a polynomial, right? Because it fails the vertical line test. But it's still 3 here. So you can always do 3. And in fact, there's a general result here. This is called the Lagrange interpolation theorem. So if you're given n distinct inputs, x1 through xn, then I get to choose any outputs. Let's say I want to send x1 to y1 all the way up through xn to yn. Any outputs, then there is a unique polynomial f of x of degree n minus 1 such that it accomplishes this. It sends x1 to y1 and all the way up through xn to yn. This is the thing that's going to solve our problem from the very beginning. Here's our problem from the very beginning. So remember, we're starting with 16 numbers, and I think I'd like to not use specific numbers for these. I'd like to give them names. Think of them as variables, so I'm going to call them A1, A2, all the way up through A15, A16. So here's the key insight that allows us to make this error-correcting code. And these codes are called Reed-Solomon codes. So this was Reed and Solomon's insight, is to encode these 16 numbers, A1, A2, up through A15, A16, as the coefficients of a degree 15 polynomial. So I use these numbers to make a polynomial. F of x equals a1 x to the 15 plus a2 x to the 14 plus a15 x plus a16.
Cool.
Okay, so same data, nothing has changed. It's just the data of these 16 numbers.
What does that curve look like?
Exactly, that's what we have to do. So let's graph this curve. So if we were to graph this curve, okay, this will just be a schematic.
Yep.
But you imagine there's some graph of this f of x. And what the Lagrange interpolation theorem tells us is that if I know just the value of this polynomial at 16 different inputs, so like x1, I know its value, at some other point, x2, I know its value, all the way 16 points on here, that uniquely determines the polynomial for me. It's the same data as knowing its value at 16 different points. So if you're over here trying to send this information online, if you want to send this, it's exactly equivalent to sending the values at 16 different points, f of x1 through f of x16. So let me come back to this Lagrange interpolation theorem and let me fill it in a little more. This n here was really the maximum. So if the points x1, y1 through xn, yn are random, then this n is actually the max. You can't specify any more values and still have it lie on the graph of a degree n minus 1 polynomial. Okay, so let's use that fact to start detecting and correcting errors. Remember, the thing we have to do is we have to build in redundancy. And so we don't have redundancy at the moment where if we just keep track of the values at 16 points. So let's take this and let's add a little more redundancy. Let's send also the value at just one more point, a 17th point. So we're gonna add in one extra point. Still no problem. It'll be the same degree 15 polynomial whose graph interpolates these 17 points. And notice that these 17 points are not random. Random 17 points would lie on no graph of a degree 15 polynomial. Okay, but now the benefit is, suppose that there's an error in transmitting this point. Instead of transmitting that value, I transmit some other value. Now, once that happens, this graph goes away. I mean, it no longer interpolates all of these points because it doesn't lie on that graph. And now if you think about it, what I have with this collection, not this one, but the erroneous one, these are now 17 points, and the internet doesn't have it out to get you, okay? It's not sending a specific really bad choice of a point. It's some random error happens in this noisy channel. So these are a random collection of 17 points, which means that probably there is no, I mean, within all likelihood, there is no degree 15 polynomial that interpolates these 17 points, because 15 is more than what you get by Lagrange. And so what we have is we have a way to figure out if there was an error. Very easy way to figure out that there was an error, but we don't have a way to correct the error, because we have to know that this point was the wrong point. If we knew that this was the wrong point, we could leave it out and find the curve through the other ones, but we don't know that. So, well, what do? Just send one more piece of data. Send its value at an 18th point. So let me add one more x here. So we're sending one more value. If we send one more value, then we will know that this is the imposter point, because the remaining points will still be 17 points that lie on the graph of a degree 15 polynomial, which is unexpected. Lagrange says we should only be able to do that with 16 points. And so we can correct our error. So if you look at this over here, this really bad way of doing it, you have to send two times as many points, but using Reed-Solomon codes, which is this idea, you only have to send one extra number, or you have to send two extra numbers, which is way better than two times the amount of numbers or three times the amount of numbers.
So when I send my credit card details, my 16 numbers, I'm sending 16 numbers plus two other numbers. Are those two other numbers?
To first order. That's the toy model of what happens. Okay. Yes.
All right. Yeah, but like they're not, all these graphs aren't being plotted by a computer and mapped and things like that. That's not actually happening.
Oh no, it's a very straightforward way to combine the data of the coefficients and get the values, or to combine the data of the values and get the coefficients. Yeah. So it's very easy. You don't have to graph it. The graphing is just what's happening behind the scenes in the mathematics. And let me say, it might not seem that impressive, right? So 16 numbers, 2 times 16 is 32 or 48. I mean, those aren't that much bigger than 17 or 18. But this 1 or 2 was independent of the number of numbers. So like a million, well, 2 million is much bigger, but a million and 1 is not so much bigger. So here's a theorem that I proved with my collaborator, Eric Larson, from last year. A curve of degree D and genus G in R dimensions